across Australia, this is Sunrise on 7 with Nat and Sherbo.
Welcome to Sunrise. We begin with breaking news out of Sydney's western suburbs, where a Christian bishop and worshippers have been stabbed in a terrifying incident that was streamed live right around the world.
The tragedy overnight prompted thousands of people to take to the streets across Fairfield, rioting and forcing police to hide behind their cars as bricks were thrown, injuring several officers. For more than 2 hours, it was chaos. We have our Sunrise team on the ground with the latest information for you. First to Matt Doran, who leads our coverage at Wakeley. Matt, police are still on the scene there.
Sherbo, they are, and they have been here in unprecedented numbers. This will give you a sense of what they arrived to. There are cars damaged all along the surrounding streets here. It is quite an alarming spectacle, really. There was a mob of thousands of people who gathered after what happened here inside this church. What was known as a Signal 1 was issued, which effectively means that police from all over Sydney, all available police, were called here to this church to help. And you can see that vision now. Unbelievably terrifying for the officers who arrived here at the scene. Now, if people are waking really horrified by what happened inside this church, a 15-year-old boy stabbing the bishop at the pulpit, and all of this, of course, while it happened live during the service being streamed live online, they'll be horrified by what took place outside. That mob turning on police, injuring a number of police, leaving them in hospital, quite unfathomable what happened here overnight.
A prominent Christian bishop under attack inside an Assyrian church. Worshippers leaping to his defence. Outside, as vision circulated on social media, tension soared, emotions running high. Thousands of angry men and women filling Fairfield streets, the riot squad called to the scene. Many officers soon becoming the target themselves. More than 30 vehicles are believed to be damaged. Inside the church, the alleged attacker pinned to the ground for hours.
Police have initially spoken to the young person. Again, his injuries are quite severe in his hand. He's fairly upset and fairly distraught. He's asked to speak to his parents at this stage, and we're making arrangements for his parents to make contact with him.
The crowd furious and desperate for answers.
It was pretty bad. A lot of people are really angry at the guy who's, you know, tried to hurt our bishop and our priest. He's our bishop. We love him very much and we want him to be okay.
Now, quite an extraordinary thing happened at about 10:30 last night. New South Wales Premier Chris Minns called an emergency meeting of faith leaders around the city. Essentially, what he has called for now, and I've got a statement here, is calling for calm in the community, calling for everyone to act with kindness and respect for each other. Now is the time to show we are strong and united as a New South Wales community. Police this morning, though, scratching their heads as to how on earth this mob of thousands decided to turn on them when they were here just to arrest this alleged 15-year-old attacker. We now know that two police in hospital with quite serious injuries. Thankfully, the bishop is in a stable condition, is expected to survive.
Yeah, just horrific all round on so many levels. Thank you, Matt. Let's go to Liam Tapper now, who's at Liverpool Hospital. More on their condition, Liam. What have you got?
Yeah, morning, Nat. Well, Liverpool Hospital, the team here, the first responders, who we all know do such an amazing job, they were working overtime last night because the Bishop Mari Emmanuel, he was rushed here. He had quite serious injuries, but as we go to air this morning, have been told that he is stabilising. He did suffer a number of those lacerations, but also on top of this, a clergyman who was there inside the church last night during the service, during that attack, the Isaac Royal, his name is, he too is in a stable condition. But as Matt was talking about that chaos and the fury that ensued on top onto those police officers, they too have suffered a number of injuries. Two constables, I've been told by police, one suffered a broken jaw. He was allegedly hit with a brick and then a fence paling. Matt was describing some of those pictures before. You could just imagine the terror that was coming onto him. There was another constable who was knocked down as well, who suffered a twisted knee. Both of those are in hospital. And I'm also told that there was a third who has been taken to Westmead, but police say that that number is only going to grow given the sheer size and scale of the mob that turned on officers. Here at Liverpool Hospital, just a number of hours ago, this was in lockdown because that mob, they'd made their way from Wakeley over here to Liverpool Hospital after their bishop was taken here, was rushed here in that serious condition. The mob has now fled. They have now moved away from the hospital, so it's much, much calmer here. But good news, I guess, for the bishop, who's now in a stable condition, guys.
Okay, thank you, Liam. Clearly, Sydney is a city on edge at the moment. There's anger within the community, understandably, but to turn against the police officers trying to do their job at that moment is just horrific.
Yeah.
Just horrific, especially after the last couple of days that we've had.
Exactly. And break into houses, which was allegedly what they were
doing. To arm themselves.
And, yeah, get weapons. Horrific.
Yeah. Yeah, we get it. Everyone's reacting. Everyone's fearful. We totally understand that. Let's get some more news now. Here's Eddie.
Thank you, Sherpa. The culture of Parliament House is in the spotlight this morning after a federal court judge found Bruce Lehrmann did rape Brittany Higgins. Let's go live to Rob Scott in Canberra. Rob, this was a very scathing ruling.
Yeah, it was, Eddie, and the judge could not have been more clear, labelling Bruce Lehrmann a liar who was hell-bent on having sex with a woman he found attractive, whether she wanted to or not. Justice Michael Lee said while it wasn't proven to a criminal standard, on the balance of probabilities, he was satisfied that Mr. Lehrmann did rape Brittany Higgins, and he says he almost got away with it after his 2022 trial was aborted and then the case against him was dropped. Justice Lee said, quote, having escaped the lion's den, Mr. Lehrmann made the mistake of coming back for his hat. And while he did find that Mr. Lehrmann had been identified by Channel 10's The Project, Justice Lee threw out his defamation case.
Mr. Lehrmann's state of mind was such that he was indifferent to Ms. Higgins' consent and just went ahead willy-nilly. Mr. Lehrmann was hell-bent on having sex with a woman he A, found sexually attractive. I am satisfied that in important respects she told deliberate lies.
After so many twists and turns in this case and all of the lives it has destroyed, there is a sense of relief here in Parliament House today that there has now been a judgment. But there's also frustration and disappointment that the pace of change here is so slow. It's been 2 years since the Sex Discrimination Commissioner Kate Jenkins' review of the culture in this building, but so far, less than half of her 28 recommendations have been implemented. Eddie?
Thank you, Rob. In breaking news from the US now, the Rust movie set Armourer, found guilty of involuntary manslaughter, has been sentenced to 18 months in prison. Hannah Gutierrez-Reed loaded the gun for actor Alec Baldwin before it fired and killed cinematographer Helena Hutchins.
You alone turned a safe weapon into a lethal weapon. But for you, Ms. Hutchins would be alive, a husband would have his partner, and a little boy would have his mother.
Alec Baldwin faces a manslaughter trial in July. Shopping centres around the country are looking at boosting their security settings as early as this week after the attack at the Bondi Junction, Westfield. In Queensland, there are calls to expand Jack's Law to allow police to scan people for weapons in shopping centres in random checks. The New South Wales government has announced an $18 million inquiry into police response and the killer's prior interactions with all government agencies. In some beautiful scenes overnight, the Sydney Opera House paid tribute to the victims with a black ribbon. The flags on the Harbour Bridge also at half-mast. Joel Couchy's sixth and final victim has been identified as a Chinese student, Li Zhencheng, who was on the phone with her fiancé at the time. 14 pro-Palestinian protesters have been arrested in Melbourne after a major day of action across the city. Let's go live to Tegan Dolling in Melbourne. Tegan, this was just kicking off during sunrise yesterday. It escalated, protesters chaining themselves to the road at one point.
Yeah, they did, Eddie. In the end, there was actually 17 protesters who were arrested. Two of them were actually found to be tampering with some of our traffic lights here in the city. 25 traffic lights went out. What the activists say was a day of causing economic pain, as we saw yesterday on sunrise. It started down here at Parliament House. They marched through the city. They blockaded businesses, chaining themselves to roads. They even at one stage decided to park a car on the Hume Freeway, as we know, that links Melbourne to Sydney, saying that that was used to transport weapon components, and they staged a major protest last night at Melbourne Central. The reason for that, they simply wanted to stop trade. As we heard yesterday from the activists, they say it was all in support of Gaza. But let me tell you, Eddie, a lot of the people that we spoke to yesterday, Melburnians, they did not support what was happening. They were actually really frustrated with the blockades and the fact that they were stuck in traffic for just so long.
Thank you, Tegan. A thick column of smoke has been spotted above Queensland's Moreton Bay as firefighters scramble to contain a commercial fire. Let's go live to Georgia Costi, who's there for us. Georgia, what do we know so far?
Well, Eddie, fire crews say that flames that climbed as high as 15 metres when this blaze broke out at the back of this tyre business in Moray Field last night. But the main concern for crews wasn't actually the fire. It was the black toxic smoke filling the air as rubber burnt. Residents in nearby suburbs were told to stay inside and shut their windows. But this business is directly opposite a really busy shopping complex, and that was another concern for fire crews, was making sure that shoppers just across the road weren't breathing it all in. Now, it did take them about 40 minutes to bring it under control, and early investigations do suggest that this could be a suspicious fire, but that will form part of the investigation, and fire investigators will return here later this morning to figure it all out, Eddie.
Thank you, Georgia. Public transport commuters in Adelaide will have to find another way to work this morning, with train strikes set to bring passenger services to a halt until 9 o'clock. It's a second strike within days as rail, tram and bus union drivers battle over pay claims. The Transport Department has advised very limited substitute bus services will be available. And still in Adelaide, a 2.7 magnitude earthquake has rocked the city, with more than 300 reports received from locals who felt those shocks overnight. Geoscience Australia said the epicentre was actually the small town of Hay Valley in the Adelaide Hills, 37 kilometres from the city centre. The quake measured a depth of 10 kilometres and is a common occurrence in the area.